Hi, my name's Brett. I'm a former combat engineer and Timor veteran, and also a recovering drug addict. I enlisted on the 31st of December 1997, straight out of high school. That started my military career. I was a reservist for about 6 months before I decided to transfer to the regular army. I got posted to the School of Military Engineering to complete my initial employment training, and then I went on to the 1st Combat Engineer Regiment at Holsworthy. When I arrived, the unit was being relocated to Darwin, and East Timor had just flared up, and the first rotation was getting ready to go overseas. I was deployed to East Timor with the 1st Combat Engineer Regiment attached to the 1st Battalion 1RR in 2000. And I didn't cope very well. While I was overseas, I was drinking heavily, even though we were in a dry area. We were resourceful and ended up finding alcohol. I became a bit of a problem for the NCOs and those in charge. It got to the point where I actually struck an NCO. I don't know why I wasn't sent back to Australia or disciplined. I probably wasn't worth the paperwork. It was a bit of a problem for those in charge. Ended up coming back to Australia in April 2001, and my mental health started to deteriorate. I was drinking heavily, started using other drugs, and it got to a point where we were training one day, and I just put down my rifle and walked away and just sat in one of the transport sheds and just sat there. I didn't know what the hell to do. I didn't know what was wrong with me. I didn't want to live, I was suicidal. They got me to see an army psychologist as well as a civilian psychiatrist. The civilian psychiatrist was of the opinion that there was something wrong and that I needed to be discharged from the military. The military psychologist's opinion was I just needed to pull my finger out and get back to work and be a professional. I didn't know what was wrong. I couldn't stop drinking at all. I started using heavier drugs, and then in 2002, they said they were going to kick me out of the military, and I just said, where do I sign? I felt that if I stayed, I would have ended up killing myself. And I was pretty much shown the door, back into civilian life, no support, no follow-up. I didn't know what was going on. I was just glad to sort of be out of the military and trying to move on to the next part of my life. I just kept drinking heavily daily. My drug use got out of control to the point where in 2007, I had my first psychotic episode. I don't know how long I was in psychosis for. They eventually picked me up because I rang 000 and asked for the ambulance and was diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder, depression. But the PTSD diagnosis didn't come till 2010. And that's the first time that I actually got involved or in touch with the Peacekeeper Association. They sort of came on deck and offered support. But I wasn't ready to stop using drugs. It's crazy. I had psychosis and schizoaffective disorder, but I didn't see stopping using as an option or a solution. I ended up selling my house that I had in Gippsland and moving to Melbourne, and my drug use just got worse, and I moved on to heavier and heavier drugs. In the end, I was an IV ice user. My whole income was being used on drugs. I was sort of disconnected from the veteran community, sort of disconnected from my family, and it got to the point where I thought, you know, I'm gonna die. I'm gonna die from this. And luckily, I kept contact numbers for the Peacekeeper Association, and I rang up and said, I need help. Australian Peacekeeper and Peacemaker Veterans Association jumped right on board. They worked to get me into a place, into some accommodation away from where I was living. Vietnam Veterans Federation helped and got me into about a house. I also started doing recovery at this point. And, you know, they talked about abstinence from all drugs, and I was just like, are you serious? That was completely alien to me. I didn't know how to cope without having something in my system. Like, it got to the point where I had to use drugs to feel normal. Like, I just could not function, like, with or without drugs. So I started, you know, the long sort of road to recovery, and I sort of learned a lot about myself. And part of, like, doing recovery, I got to the core reasons why I use drugs. And it turned out that I hated myself. Yeah, through a lot of recovery and a great psychologist and a good psychiatrist. Like, I've had my psychiatrist for over a decade now. He sort of treated me when I moved to Melbourne and was, like, in the throes of addiction. And he's seen me come full circle to a point now where I've been in recovery for about 6 years. And so far I've been abstinent for 3 years now, off all drugs, including alcohol. I've got to a point now where DVA have recognised my mental health issues, and I do have support. But that's only been through the work of my Veterans Association and my treating doctor. And I've gone back to school to try and learn something new. And I want to try and work again. Like, I haven't had a job, a proper job, like, probably over a decade. For me, what sort of helped was when I got into recovery and met other recovering drug addicts and saw that, you know, there was a way to live drug-free and I could have a good life. And, you know, I don't have to put a drug in my system each day to feel normal. Like, I felt real freedom from addiction that I've sort of never felt before, because I just thought, you know, I'm going to use till I die. You know, like, I've still got friends that I served with overseas. And, you know, I was brutally honest with them. Like, one of them is a Northern Territory copper. And, you know, I was like, you know, we served together in the same section. And he's like family, and it's like, you know, I don't care. Like, I'm just going to tell him what's going on because he's my mate. And, you know, he didn't judge me. He didn't look down on me or, you know, tell me to piss off. Like, he sort of, and when I put my hand up and said, I need help, like, there was help there. It's just, I had to get to a point where I felt I couldn't go any further, or, you know, as I said, I thought I was going to die. I don't know, the future, you know, I'm looking forward to, like, what's coming up next. You know, I've been abstinent now for multiple years, and I'm looking at the possibility of working again and being a contributing member of the community. You know, like, I'm not a burden on the community anymore. Like, I'm actually contributing to it. I try and do volunteer work for the association that helped me out, you know, like, and, you know, just be there. Like, I'm part of a member of another group called Angel Squad, which is younger veterans that have drug and alcohol issues, and we meet regularly, weekly, and part of the program is to get up, to clean up, and to show up, and, you know, like, having a routine, like, that I do every day. You know, I've got good real friends, you know, like, when I was using drugs, the only time I'd see people is if I had money or gear, you know, and I haven't heard from the people since I got clean, the people I used with. Just the friendships that I have made in the veteran community, and the friends that I have sort of stuck with me through all this, you know, like, you know, it strengthened those relationships. And yeah, I don't hate myself today. You know, I don't have to get up in the morning and drink or shoot ice or any of that sort of stuff. You know, I do normal things. You know, I pay bills. I've got a cat. You know, I've got a nice place to live. You know, I've got goals and things that I want to do, and you know, my family are really proud of me. You know, like they've seen me, like they didn't think I was gonna make it, and just being able to be there now, like for simple things like Christmas and like birthdays and dropping, like my mum lives in the next suburb, you know, like so I can drop around and say hello, and you know, they don't have to go to bed at night worrying whether they're gonna get a knock at the door. To say that I've like died. The life I've got now is pretty good, you know. I'm on medication for the rest of my life, but you know, I accept that. I don't regret like the path that I've walked. You know, it's made me the man I am today, and I'm actually happy with who I am. And yeah, I've got a bit of peace. There's help out there if you want it. You can get clean, you can live without drugs, and you can have a new life. You know, it's all possible. But I suppose, like as addicts, like we have to be the ones who sort of say, you know, we need help, we want to change, because unless that happens, like it's just gonna, like if nothing changes, nothing changes. You know. I'm pretty grateful that I've like had a second chance at life or what I've achieved. Like, you know, like I've been clean off all drugs for 3 years. You know, like I didn't think that I'd be able to get a day clean, let alone 3 years, like when I started recovery. You know, I got my family back in my life. You know, my mates are so proud of me. You know, I got to serve my country overseas, like on active service in operations, you know, like I started doing Anzac Day again. Like I obviously don't go and drink or any of that, but I do stay clean and sober as a mark of respect. I don't regret anything that I've done. You know, the service I'm proud of, like as I said, I wouldn't change anything. I'm glad I joined as an 18-year-old out of high school. And you know, I'm glad I walked the path that I've walked. Like I'm glad, like I got, you know, I served with the UN, you know, like, you know, like, yeah, I'm pretty proud of my service, even though like my life unfolded the way it did. Like I don't regret anything. Yeah, like as I said, like I've got to the point where I'm studying at a university level, and there is the possibility, even though I'm TPI at the moment, I am looking at the possibility of trying to work again. And that's like my goal, moving forward from here, is to see if I can actually sustain employment in a 9-to-5 job, with the rest of society. Because, yeah, I've sort of come full circle. And, yeah, like the future looks good.